Welcome to an intro to the inverse functions of sine, cosine, and tangent. The goals of the video are to define the inverse functions for sine, cosine, and tangent, graph the inverse functions of sine, cosine, and tangent, and then use the inverse functions to solve problems. So remember from the video inverse functions, only one-to-one functions have inverse functions. And sine, cosine, and tangent in their current form are not one-to-one functions. Each of these fails the horizontal line test because this horizontal line intersects the graph in more than one point. So we cannot find the inverse functions of these in their current form. What we can do is restrict the domain of a function to make it one-to-one without changing the range. And this allows us to determine inverse functions that we otherwise would not be able to. So for example, if we consider the function f of x equals x squared on the interval from 0 to infinity, this is a one-to-one function, which allows us to find the inverse function, which we otherwise could not on the interval from negative infinity to infinity. And the inverse operation of squaring is square rooting. So here in red, we see our inverse function, f inverse of x equals the square root of x. And if we graph them on the coordinate plane with y equals x, again, we can see the symmetry across the line y equals x. Now for y equals sine x, we restrict the domain to the closed interval from negative pi over 2 to pi over 2. And I've graphed that here in red below. So again, for this graph, our domain is from negative pi over 2 to pi over 2 on the closed interval. And the range is still from negative 1 to 1 on the closed interval. Now the inverse function of sine is given as y equals inverse sine of x or y equals arcsine of x. There's two ways to write the inverse function of y equals sine x. It's graphed here on the right below, and there's some important things to remember. The process for finding this inverse is to interchange the x and the y variables. And by interchanging the x and the y variables, we're interchanging the domain and the range. Notice the domain of y equals sine x is the range of inverse sine of x. And the range of sine x is the domain of inverse sine x. So the input will be the sine function value, and the output y will be the angle that produces that sine function value. For y equals cosine x, we restrict the domain to the closed interval from 0 to pi, and we have it graphed here in blue below. And notice our range is still on the closed interval from negative 1 to positive 1. The inverse function of y equals cosine x is y equals inverse cosine x, or y equals arc cosine x. Again, these mean exactly the same thing. They're the inverse of y equals cosine x. And it's graphed here on the right. Again, it's important that we notice the domain of y equals cosine x is the range of y equals inverse cosine x. And the range of y equals cosine x is the domain of y equals inverse cosine x. So the input for y equals inverse cosine of x is the cosine function value, and the output, or the y value, is the angle that produces the cosine function value. And lastly, we have y equals tangent x. And for this function, we restrict the domain to the open interval from negative pi over 2 to pi over 2, again, graphed here in green. And for the range, it still is from negative infinity to positive infinity. And the inverse of y equals tangent x is given as y equals inverse tangent x, or y equals arctangent x. And it's graphed here on the right. And once again, notice that the domain, or the input, is going to be the tangent function value, and the output, or the range, will be the angle that produces that tangent function value. Okay, let's take a look at some problems. We want to find the exact value for each real number y, and then use the calculator to check our work. Now what I did here in green was list the output, or the range, for each of these inverse trig functions, so we know that the value of y must be in this given interval. What I've also done is included the reference triangles, the 30, 60, 90, and the 45, 45, 90 reference triangles. And these will be very helpful in solving these problems. So when we look at number 1, y equals arcsine negative square root 3 over 2, The first thing we should do is take a look at what would the reference angle be for square root 3 over 2. And hopefully you're pretty good at this now. You can see the reference angle would be a 60 degree reference angle, because that gives you the opposite over hypotenuse of square root 3 over 2. Even though this is negative, this will tell us what our reference angle is, and then we can determine which quadrant it would be in. So if our angle must be in this interval, we must be in either the first or the fourth quadrant. We can't be in the first because all values are positive in that quadrant, so we're going to be in quadrant 2 with the negative 60 degree reference angle. And in fact, negative 60 degrees is in this interval, so that is the value of arc sine negative square root 3 over 2. If we want this in radians, it would be negative pi over 3. Okay, for number 2, we have y equals arc cosine square root 2 over 2. Remember, the range or the output for arc cosine is on the closed interval from 0 to pi. So now our angle must be in either the first or the second quadrant. Next, the cosine function value is square root 2 over 2, which should remind you of a reference angle of 45 degrees. Adjacent over hypotenuse would be 1 over square root 2. Rationalized would be square root 2 over 2. So we have a 45 degree reference angle, and since we have positive square root 2 over 2, we're in the first quadrant. And this is the angle we're looking for. It's equal to 45 degrees, which is pi over 4 radians. We have y equals arctangent negative 1. Remember, the output for this will be on the open interval from negative pi over 2 to pi over 2. So now we're in either the first or the fourth quadrant. And this negative 1 is the tangent function value we're looking for, the angle. Having a tangent function value of negative 1 should remind you of another reference angle of 45 degrees. Tangent of 45 degrees is 1 over 1, which gives us 1. But because our tangent function value is negative, we can't be in the first quadrant. We'll be in the fourth quadrant with a reference angle of 45 degrees. But in this interval, we're actually looking at an angle that is negative 45 degrees, equal to negative pi over 4 radians. So we can use the reference triangles to help us solve these problems. We can also use a unit circle, so you might want to try that as well. For number 1, I'll press second sine and then type in negative square root 3 over 2. And that checks the first one. Now we'll press second cosine for number 2. And then our cosine function value is square root 2 over 2. Second one checks out. And the last one, we'll press second tangent, negative 1, enter. So they all three check out. Okay, let's take a look at one more problem. We want to solve this right triangle. So we'll go ahead and start off by finding the hypotenuse by using the Pythagorean theorem. Let's call this x. We have x squared equals 5 squared plus 15 squared. So x squared equals 25 plus 225, that's 250. And we'll take the square root of both sides. Let's go ahead and round to two decimal places. This comes out to approximately 15.81. Okay, so that's review, but remember, to solve a right triangle, we have to find the length of all three sides and the measure of all three angles. We know this is 90 degrees. Let's call this angle A. And the tangent of angle A must equal opposite over hypotenuse, or 5 15ths, which does simplify to 1 3rd. Now, to solve this equation for A, we can take the inverse tangent of both sides. And on the left side, if we take the inverse tangent of tangent A, these two undo each other. We have angle A is approximately equal to inverse tangent of 5 15ths. So angle A is approximately 18.43 degrees. And to find angle A and B must be complementary or add to 90 degrees. So that leaves us with angle B equal to 71.57 degrees. Now, one thing you should be careful about is this is a rounded value. So it's best to use arctangent or inverse tangent to find these angles, because these two are precise and this one is rounded. So it may result in an error if we use the hypotenuse to find the measure of angle A and angle B. Okay, I hope you found this video helpful. Thank you for watching.